Oh, and just so sure of that?
For the very simple reason that I see the dog himself is on our doorstep. And that was the ring of its owner.
Two gentlemen to see you, Mr. Holmes. I told them they had to leave the dog outside.
Very well, they may enter. See the door, I want to leave.
Thank goodness you found it. I couldn't remember where I left it. This stick is quite precious to me.
A gift, I see.
Yes.
From Charing Cross Hospital?
Yes, from some friends as a wedding gift.
Damn! A wedding present, you say?
Yes, what's wrong?
Only that you've disproved one of our little deductions about you. No matter, allow me to introduce to you a friend of mine, Dr. Watson. And to inquire as to what brings you to my door here today.
How rude of me. I'm Dr. James Mortimer, and this is Sir Henry Baskerville.
Oh, Sir Henry. Please, have a seat.
So, Sir Henry has only just arrived in England yesterday, and he's already been plagued by a series of strange events. But first, perhaps, I should say what brought him to England in the first place.
Oh, well, please do.
With your permission?
Of course.
I am the executor of the late Sir Charles Baskerville's estate. Charles was the uncle of Sir Henry here. I was also his friend and his attending physician. Approximately 3 months ago, before his untimely death, he presented me with this manuscript detailing an old family legend, the Hound of the Baskervilles.
Some 250 years ago, the cruel Sir Hugo Baskerville abducted a young girl. She escaped, and she fled across the moor. In a rage, Sir Hugo promised his body and soul to the powers of evil if he could but catch her. He released his hounds, and he pursued her. Three drunken companions followed. They found the girl dead, of fear and fatigue upon the moor. And beside her, the body of Sir Hugo Baskerville, who even as they watched, had the throat torn out of him by a great black beast shaped like a hound. One of the companions died that very night, and the other two were but broken men for the rest of their days. Here, Watson, listen to this. And so I counsel you, by way of caution, to forbear from crossing the moor in those dark hours when the powers of evil are exalted.
Well, don't you find that interesting?
Melodrama, more like. It is a fairy tale.
Well, Sir Charles took that quite seriously.
And you, Dr. Mortimer, do you take it seriously? Do you, Sir Henry?
It's just an old family story to frighten children who behave.
Before Sir Charles's death, I wouldn't have believed a word of it either. But the circumstances behind his death just don't add up. They can't all be addressed by the settled order of nature.
I find that unlikely. Please, tell me the facts.
On the evening of May the 4th, Sir Charles announced that he was going to go to London the next day. He ordered his servant Barrymore to prepare his luggage. Sir Charles was in the habit of going out for a cigar after dinner and for a walk along the Yew Alley at Baskerville Hall. That night, he never returned. When Barrymore realized it was long past the time that Sir Charles typically returned to go to bed, he went out to look for
and found him dead?
Yes, exactly.
Were there any signs of foul play?
None. Sir Charles's face was terribly distorted, but Sir Charles had a heart condition, and I believed that it was simply due to the pain of a heart attack. The post-mortem exam agreed with me.
Believed? You mean to tell me that you don't believe it now?
There is no doubt that Sir Charles died from a heart attack.
And yet you have your questions.
Not about the heart attack itself, but about the cause of it.
The cause of it? But you just said the man had a heart condition.
Indeed he did, but that doesn't address all of the confusing circumstances surrounding his death.
Then please, Dr. Mortimer, tell us everything.
I could tell for several months that Sir Charles's nerves were quite frayed. He took the legend of the hound very seriously, and he believed that a dreadful fate hung over the family. He would walk upon his own grounds, but nothing would convince him to go out upon the moor at night. I believed that a trip to London would soothe his nerves and allow him to come back refreshed. I felt that no matter how superstitious his fears were, the effects on his health were quite real. Stapleton, a mutual friend, agreed with me. Unfortunately, that very night, Sir Charles was found dead upon the yew alley.
Describe this yew alley.
It consists of two rows of ancient yew hedge, 12 feet high and utterly impenetrable. Down the center is a gravel path approximately 8 feet wide. On either side of the gravel path, there's grass strips approximately 6 feet wide. Roughly halfway down the path, there's a gate out onto the moor.
Is there any other opening?
There's a summer house at the far end.
Had Sir Charles reached this?
No, he was found approximately 50 yards short of that.
His footprints, they were very clear in the gravel, I assume?
Yes, and this is where it starts to get strange.
How exactly?
Well, they were quite normal coming down from the house, and I could tell that he stood by the gate for a little while.
Why is that?
The ash from his cigar. There was enough there to indicate that he'd stood there for at least 10 minutes.
Excellent. Why, Watson, this is a gentleman after our own hearts. Now, continue on about the footprints, please.
This is where they change. It looked like when he left the gate, he was walking on his toes.
On his toes?
Yes, I don't understand that either. Why should he walk tiptoe down the alley?
He wasn't. He was running. Running desperately. Running for his life. Running until his heart burst.
Yes, but what was he running from?
Now therein lies the problem.
And one I may be able to help with. Barrymore told the police that he saw no other footprints upon the path. But he was wrong. I saw Barrymore's, of course, and Sir Charles's. But I also saw one other.
A man's or a woman's?
Neither. It was the footprint of a gigantic hound.
You saw this?
Yes, as clearly as I see you.
Why is it that no one else saw it?
Well, the footprint was approximately 20 yards from the body, and I'm sure no one else thought it was important. I only noticed it because I know the legend of the hound.
Are there many sheepdog out on the moor?
Plenty, but this was no sheepdog.
The footprint was large, you say?
Enormous.
Tell me, Doctor, why did you not bring this to my attention sooner?
Well, it appears to be that your area of expertise is in the natural world.
You mean to tell me that you believe the thing is supernatural?
There have been a number of circumstances going on in the county that can't be all reconciled with the settled order of nature.
For example?
A number of people in the days leading up to Sir Charles's death reported seeing a creature corresponding to the Baskerville demon of legend. This creature couldn't be any animal known to science. They all describe a huge creature, luminous, ghastly, and spectral. I have cross-examined these men personally, and they all tell a story completely corresponding to the Baskerville legend.
And yet, you, who are a trained man of science, believe the thing to be supernatural.
I don't know what to believe.
Yet, surely you must admit that the footprint at least was real.
Yes, and the hound in the legend was real enough to tear a man's throat out, but it was diabolical as well.
But tell me now, if you hold these views, why have you come to consult me at all? You tell me that it is impossible to investigate the death of Sir Charles, yet in the same breath that you desire me to do it.
I never asked you to investigate Sir Charles's death.
Well then, how may I assist you?
By helping me decide what to do with Sir Henry here.
You are the heir?
I am, sir.
There is no other claimant, I presume?
None. Sir Charles was the eldest of three brothers, and he died widowed and alone. The middle brother was Sir Henry's father, and he died young. The final brother, Roger, was the black sheep of the family, although I've been told that he looks nearly identical to the picture of old Hugo back at the hall. Roger turned to a life of crime and made England far too hot for himself, so he fled to Central America, where he contracted yellow fever and died alone and childless.
I, sir, am the last of the Baskervilles.
Well then, why not simply return to your ancestral home?
Well, that certainly would be the logical choice. Sir Charles was doing some wonderful work to improve the poor countryside. If the hall remains empty, all of that work shall go for naught. But it appears that every Baskerville that goes to the hall meets an evil fate. I must admit that I am far too close to this situation to give an honest opinion, so we came to you.
So what you're telling me is that in your opinion, there seems to be some diabolical agency which makes Devonshire unsafe for a Baskerville.
It certainly appears that way.
Yet, surely, if your supernatural theory is correct, it could do Sir Henry evil here in London as easily as in Devonshire. A devil with many powers, such as a local vestry, would be too inconceivable of a thing.
So you're suggesting that Sir Henry here would be just as safe in Devonshire as he would be in London?
Indeed.
And yet, I have been plagued by mysteries already, and I only just arrived yesterday. It seems as though there's no place in England that is safe for me.
Well, then, Sir Henry, let us examine these mysteries. Please, you must tell me everything.
Well, there's this letter for a start, if you want to call it a letter, which I got this morning.
Sir Henry Baskerville, Northumberland Hotel. Who knew that you were going to be at that particular hotel?
Well, no one could have known. We've only agreed to go there after I met Dr. Mortimer at the train station.
Were you already staying there?
No, I was staying with friends.
There's no way anyone could have known that we've intended to go to that hotel.
Well, someone seems to be very interested in your movements. Look here. As you value your life or your reason, keep away from the moor.
Yes. And what on earth does that mean? And who is taking such interest in my affair?
What do you make of it, Dr. Mortimer? Surely you must admit that there's nothing supernatural about this, at any rate.
Yes, but it could have been written by someone who believes the whole affair to be supernatural.
Common polity. The address is printed in rough characters. The postmark is Charing Cross, and the date, yesterday evening. Cheap paper. No watermark. The message appears to be composed by pasting words cut from the Times. All except for the word more, which appears printed in a heavy hand.
Why was the word more handwritten?
Well, because you could not find it in print. The other words you see are all common enough and may be found in any newspaper. But the word more would be less common.
Can you see anything else?
One or two things, despite the fact that the utmost pains have been taken to remove all clues. The message you see is printed in rough characters, but The Times is a paper read by only the highly educated. Therefore, we may assume that the composer of this letter was an educated man who wished to pose as an uneducated one. And the attempt to conceal his handwriting suggests that the handwriting may be known, or may become to be known, by you.
How can you be so sure that the words were cut from the Times?
The Times has a uniquely distinctive typeface, Watson, one that I'm quite familiar with. If you'll notice, you see, the words are not pasted on in an accurate line. That may point to carelessness on the part of the writer, or it may point to worry on the part of the writer. Now, since the matter was of evidently importance, it is safe that we can assume that the writer would not be careless. So, if the writer were in a hurry, it poses interesting questions of why he should be in a hurry. Did the writer fear an interruption? And if so, from whom?
Aren't we venturing into the area of guesswork now?
Not at all, but rather into the region where we balance probabilities and choose the one most likely. Now, you would call it a guess, no doubt, but I am almost certain that this letter was written in a hotel.
How can you say that?
If you'll examine it very carefully, you will see that the pen and the ink have given the writer some trouble. Now, the pen has spluttered twice in a single word, and the ink has run dry three times in a short address, which suggests very little ink in the bottle. Now, a private ink bottle or pen is seldom to be allowed in such a state, and the combination of the two must be quite rare. But you know, the hotel ink and the hotel pen, when it is rare to get anything else. I fear that this letter could have been written in any hotel in the Charing Cross area. I think we've deduced as much as we can from this curious letter. So, on to the next problem, Sir Henry. Oh.
Well, it started out simple enough. I thought it was just the hotel staff being careless, but I'll be damned if it hasn't gotten downright odd.
Well, you must tell me everything, Sir Henry. Please, leave out no detail, no matter how trivial it may seem.
Last night, I dropped off a pair of boots to be cleaned. But when they were returned this morning, there was only one. I complained to the chap who does the cleaning, but he insisted that he left them both. The strange part is that they were brand new. I never even had them on my feet.
Well, that seems like a rather useless thing to steal.
But that's not the odd part. After Dr. Mortimer and I had breakfast, we returned to notice that the new boot had been returned, but now one of my old ones is missing.
An old boot, you say?
Yes, one of a pair that I had brought with me from Canada.
Well, that is very interesting indeed. And it's a matter that deserves our attention, but not something we can pursue just now. What else?
Just one more thing. Seems I've walked into a dying novel, as it seems I've been followed.
Followed, you say?
By a man in a cab with a thick, black, bushy beard. We noticed him while we were walking over here from the hotel. As soon as he saw that we had spotted him, he shouted to the driver and the cab flew off, what was it, Regent Street. We couldn't hope to chase him down.
Could you swear to the man's face?
Only to the beard.
Aha! Then it was most likely a false one. A clever man on such an errand has no use to wear a beard other than to conceal his features. What about you, Dr. Mortimer? Did you see any of this?
Unfortunately, no. The cab was already fleeing before I realized there was anything wrong.
Well, it appears that someone is very interested in your movements. How else would someone have known so quickly that you were staying at the Northumberland Hotel? We're dealing with a very clever man here, Watson. Dr. Moore, amongst your neighbors and your acquaintances out on the moor, are there any men with a full black beard?
Barrymore has a full black beard.
Ah, and what do we know of him?
He's the son of the old caretaker who's died. Their family has taken care of the hall for four generations now. To the best of my knowledge, Barrymore and his wife are as good people as anyone else in the county.
Did Sir Charles leave anything to Barrymore in his will?
Yes, Barrymore and his wife each received £500.
Indeed. Did they know they were going to receive this?
Yes, Sir Charles was quite open about the terms of his will.
That is very interesting.
Well, I hope you're not suspecting everyone who received a gift from Sir Charles's will. I myself received £1,000.
Indeed. And anyone else?
There were several other individuals and public charities who received gifts from the will. The rest went to Sir Henry here.
And how much was that?
£740,000.
Good. I had no idea that so dramatic of a sum was involved. That is a sum for which a man might play at a very desperate game. Now, Sir Henry, what do we have to decide is whether or not it is advisable for you to return to Baskerville Hall.
And just why shouldn't I go?
Well, there appears to be danger.
From the family's devil hound or from human beings?
That is what we must find out.
Well, my mind is made up. There's no devil in hell or man on earth that can stop me from going to the old estate. And that is my final word.
I agree with you that you should go down to Devonshire without delay. I must insist, however, upon one thing, and that is that you do not go alone.
Well, talk to Mortimer to return.
But Dr. Mortimer has his own practice, his own domestic responsibilities. No, he may be unable to help you in a time of need. I would have you take a trustworthy man and be always by his side.
Can't you come yourself?
No, unfortunately I cannot. One of the most revered names in London is being threatened by a blackmailer, and only I can stop a disastrous scandal. I cannot be in town.
Well, who do you suggest then?
If Watson would consent to it, there is no one better to have with you in a tight space. No one can say more confidently than I.
Well, that'd be very kind of you. If you come down to Baskerville Hall and see me through, I'll never forget it.
Of course I'll come with you.
Always stay by his side, Watson. I place Sir Henry's safety entirely in your capable hands. If a crisis should arise, and it will, I will direct you how to act.
Dr. Mortimer and I have tickets to the train from Paddington at 10:30 tomorrow. You can meet us there and travel with us.
I'd be happy to.
Great.
Then our plans are settled, gentlemen. Good morning.
Dr. Mortimer, thank you for introducing me to such a fascinating problem. And to you, Sir Henry, I advise you caution. I cannot emphasize strongly enough that you do not go out onto the moor alone, especially at night. Until we discover the true nature of this threat, it is imperative that you take no unnecessary risks.
Of course, Mr. Holmes. Thank you.
Thank you. Pleasure.
Good morning.
Good morning. I tell you, Watson, we've never had a foe more worthy of our steel. I wish you luck in Devonshire, but I am not easy about it.
About what?
About sending you. It is an ugly, dangerous game. And the more I hear of it, the less I like it.
Well, what do you want me to do?
Only to report the facts as completely as you can. Leave me to do any theorizing.
What sort of facts?
Anything that seems to have any bearing upon the case, but most importantly, the relationship between Sir Henry and his neighbours out on the moor, or any new details concerning the death of Sir Charles.
Don't you think we should just get rid of this Barrymore couple?
Absolutely not. You couldn't make a worse mistake. If they're innocent, why, it would be a cruel injustice. If they're guilty, well, we'd be ruining our chance of bringing it home to them. No. We'll keep them on our list of suspects for now. You must investigate all of the names out on the moor. Remember, Watson, no one is above suspicion, not even Dr. Mortimer or this mutual friend, Stapleton.
I'll do my best.
You'll take arms?
Yes, that's what I should.
Most assuredly. Keep your revolver on you day and night, and never relax your precautions. Oh. and remind Sir Henry of the quote from that old legend, and avoid the moor in those dark hours when the powers of evil are exalted.
Considerable staff. You don't mean you want to leave?
Only when it is convenient to you, sir.
But your family has served mine for several generations now. I don't want to start my life here by breaking an old family connection.
Well, neither would I, sir, but...
We were both very much attached to Sir Charles, and his death gave us quite a shock. Made these surroundings very painful to us. I fear we will never again be comfortable at Baskerville Hall.
Well said, Eliza. That's the truth of it, sir.
Well, what will you do then?
Sir Charles' generosity has given us the means to start some small business.
We'll make do, sir.
Well, I hate to see you leave, but I guess I can understand your reasons.
I'll make arrangements as soon as I can. Thank you.
Very well. I assume you know the countryside fairly well.
As well as any man, sir.
What can you tell me of the neighbors? Who else lives out on the moor?
Well, there's Dr. Franklin and his wife. Dr. Mortimer, I'm sorry, dear. There's Mr. Franklin. There's Mr. Stapleton and his sister. Some local farmers and shepherds. That's about it, sir. If people want any services, they usually go to Coombe Tracy. That's where you arrive on the train, sir.
Of course. Thank you, ma'am.
Sir, and now perhaps I should show you to your rooms. Please.
It's not a very cheerful place, is it?
No wonder my uncle got a little jumpy living alone in a place like this.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me, now here on the moor, we don't usually wait for formal introductions. I'm sure you've heard me from our mutual friend, Dr. Mortimer. I am Jack Stiglitz.
Oh, yes, of course, your butterfly net gave you away. Dr. Mortimer, tell me you're a collector, but how do you know me?
Oh, I was in Mortimer's office when he pointed you out to me from the window. Since we were going the same way, I thought I should introduce myself. How is Sir Henry?
Very well, thank you.
I think we're all very glad that he's here. I'm sure you know that Sir Charles is doing some excellent work in the community, and have passed a bit before. Well, it just couldn't continue. Sir Henry isn't worried about that silly Howard legend, is he?
No, not at all.
Well, that's good. It really is amazing how gullible the people around here are. So many of them are prepared to swear they've seen such a creature out on the moor. Of course, Sir Charles took it so seriously, I fear it had something to do with his death.
No.
He was so worked up about it that I was afraid seeing any old dog might seduce a half cap. He was a really good friend, you know, and I did know of his heart condition.
How did you know about that?
Mortimer told me.
So your theory is that any dog could have chased Sir Charles out onto the moor and he died of fright because of it?
Do you have a better explanation?
No, I'm afraid I don't.
Does Mr. Sherlock Holmes?
How did you...
You didn't think we wouldn't know who you are, did you? Your stories are famous. If you're involved, Sherlock Holmes must be as well, and naturally, I'm very curious to know his opinions on the matter.
I'm afraid I can't say.
Is he coming down here himself?
No, he's far too busy with other cases to leave town.
Well, that's a shame. I'm sure he could have shown some light on the whole mess. But if there's anything I can do to assist you, do let me know.
I'm only here to visit my friend Sir Henry, and with that I don't need any help.
I understand. I will bring it up again. My house is just down the road a short ways. If you have some time, I could introduce you to my sister.
Well, Sir Henry said he'd be busy with paperwork all morning, so yes, I have some time.
Excellent. It really is a wonderful place, the moor. You never believe all the wonderful secrets it contains. It's so vast and so barren and so mysterious.
You know it well, then, do
you? Oh, I've only been here 2 years. The locals still call me a newcomer. We settled in there shortly after Sir Charles moved to the hall. But my hobby has led me to explore every part of the countryside, and I like to think there are a few men who know as well as I do.
Well, is it really so unusual?
Oh, very. For example, look here. Do you see this hilly land to the north? Does anything strike you about it?
Looks like a good place to take a horse for a gallop.
Ah, you think so? But many have lost their lives because of it. Do you see the brighter green patches scattered all around it?
Yes, they look more fertile than the rest.
That is the Great Grimpen Mine, a vast and dangerous swampland where one false step can be fatal. Step into that mud and you'll be sacked right down and never heard from again. See here, do you see that wild moor pony? Just last week I saw another one wander into the mire and never come out again. This one looks to be doing the same. Poor beast. They get used to the land when it's dry, you see, and don't know it's no longer safe after the rains. That's when it turns downright deadly. But even in these conditions, I can find my way safely to the heart of it and back out there. There are a few safe paths that I've found.
I can't imagine why anyone would want to.
Well, the hills you see are really islands, cut off on all sides by the impassable mire. That's where the rarest plants and butterflies live.
Oh, I might give it a try myself one day.
For God's sakes, please don't. I never forgive myself if you got lost in the mire and drowned. Just trust me, the safe paths are difficult to find and even more so to follow. Forget that I even said anything. But look here. What do you make of those round structures?
What are they? Sheep pens?
No, they're all that's left of primitive houses. A prehistoric man lived there, and no one has since. So the ruins are left undisturbed.
It's quite a town. What did they do?
Oh, graze sheep on slopes, I suppose. Maybe learn to dig for tin when bronze swords began. That's a cyclopides. Please, excuse me a moment.
Go back to London. Go straight back to London now.
What? Why?
I can't explain that, but for God's sake, just go. Get out of here and never return.
What if I only just got here?
Oh, men! Can't you tell when a warning is for your own good? Go back to London. Get away from here at all costs. My brother's coming. Would you mind getting that locket over there for me? The moor is full of them, but of course, you're too late to see the true beauties of the place.
Hello, Beryl.
Well, Jack, you're awfully out of breath.
Yes, I was chasing a cyclopean. They're very rare, hardly ever found in late autumn. I've been chasing them since August. It's a pity that I missed you. But the two of you have introduced yourselves, I see.
Yes, I was just telling Sir Henry here about the beauties of the moor.
Sir Henry? No, I'm afraid you're mistaken. I'm not Sir Henry. I'm just a friend of his. My name's Dr. Watson.
Oh,
I apologize.
Oh, no, I'm done. We were just talking
about the orchids.
Oh, yes.
But, of course, Dr. Watson here wouldn't care whether he's early or late for the orchids if he's just a visitor.
But, this is a rather odd place to settle down, don't you think?
Oh, we managed to keep ourselves fairly happy, don't you, Belle?
Quite happy.
I had a school, you see, in the North Country. I enjoy helping to shape young minds, but a tragedy struck. An epidemic swept through the school, and three of the young boys died. The school was closed, and I lost most of my money. But it's all turned out all right in the end, and now I have the wide open countryside to satisfy my taste for botany and zoology. Luckily, Meryl here loves nature just as much as I do.
Well, it did occur to me that you'd get rather bored.
Oh, no, I'm never bored.
We have a collection of interesting books and even more interesting neighbours. Which reminds me, I do miss old Sir Charles more than I can say. Do you think that Sir Henry would mind if we came out to the hall and introduced ourselves?
No, I'd certainly be delighted.
Oh, wonderful. Would you like to come back to the house for some lunch?
No, I'm afraid I can't. I really should be getting back to the hall.
Jack, isn't that the sacred Humphreys again?
Where?
Over there.
So it is!
I'm very sorry for mistaking for Sir Henry. Please forget everything I've said.
But I can't forget about him, Miss Stapleton. Sir Henry is my friend and his safety is my concern. Why are you so eager for him to return to London?
Do you know about the hound?
I don't believe in such nonsense.
But I do. Please, if you can persuade him at all, get him to go far from here.
Unless you can tell me something more definite, I'm afraid I won't be able to get him to budge.
I can't say anything definite. I don't know anything definite.
I got him!
And worse, but I got him!
Would you like to come back and help me add this one to the collection? I do believe it's the largest in all of Southern England.
I'm quite sure I should return.
Well, if you're sure. Come along, Ben.
It was a pleasure to meet you.
And you, Miss Stapleton.
Pardon. So, I've been keeping an eye out.
Well, that's very civic-minded of you.
That's me, Your Lord.
back to Watson. You know what I mean. Very civic-minded I am. That's why I keep having all these lawsuits. As I said before, people around here don't respect the rule of the law. And you need to be reminded that the law is a law and not to be ignored. That's why I fight with the local magistrates and take the case to the higher courts. Can't have them thinking they're going to rough shot over the race of the common people.
Indeed not.
It's all the same with the upper class checks, too, you know.
Oh, begging Sir Henry's pardon and pleasant company stood and all that.
Think you had to work the man, it's no business on the door. Why don't you see the
thing? Where are you going, Meadow?
Now?
Now.
Thank you, Sir Henry, for our wonderful dinner.
Yes, thank you. Good night.
Absolutely.
Well, that was damn odd.
Well, seems like the night's winding down anyhow. I should be getting along myself.
Come around sometime, why don't you not go out? Try your telescope. Ha! It's a damn sight more interested in staples than water, I'll tell you that.
Sounds an excellent idea, Mr. Franklin. Thank you.
Good night, Sir Henry. Dr. Watson?
See.
Thank you, lad. Cold out here tonight. No more.
Well, it is getting rather late. I think I'll turn in. How about you, Sir Henry?
In a minute. I'm going to finish this drink. Have a good night.
Good night, Sir Henry.
Very much, sir.
What's all this?
My new clothes arrived from the tailor. I thought Barrymore could have some use for my old ones.
Indeed, sir. You are most generous.
I want to have a talk with you about some strange goings-on around the house.
Oh? What?
Well, on my first night here, and every night since, I could swear that I heard a woman cry.
Yes. Yes, I think I've heard that too.
Well, I finally got around to asking Mrs. Barrymore about it. Since she's the only woman in the house, I assumed it must be her. She denies it, but it's obvious that she's lying. The bags under her eyes and the way her hand trembled when I asked her about it. The question is, why is she crying and why is she lying about it?
You think Barrymore's abusive? He doesn't seem the type.
No, but he is a rather odd fellow.
Oh? Why do you say that?
Well, last night, very late, around 2 a.m, I heard him creeping along the halls. So I went to investigate, and I found him with a lit candle standing in front of the window. He stood there for several minutes, put it out and sighed, but I quickly crept back to my room and heard him come back my way a few minutes later.
I knew that he crept the halls at night. I've heard him too, coming and going around the same time. I've been meaning to talk to him about that.
You know, it's very possible that he goes to that same window every night.
Maybe so. We should follow him and see what he's up to. Well, what do Holmes do about this?
Exactly that.
Then we'll do it tonight.
Agreed.
In the meantime, I have an appointment to keep. think you're going?
Well, that depends. Are you going out onto the moor?
Yes.
You know my instructions. Holmes said that you are not allowed on the moor on your own.
Holmes couldn't foresee everything. Now, don't be a spoil sport. I have to go out alone.
Ah, you're talking about Miss Stapleton. I see the way you two look at each other when you're together.
Well, she is beautiful and charming.
No, yes, she is. But have you noticed how her brother glares at you whenever you show her the slightest affection?
When me and her are together, I am paying no attention to her brother. I can assure you that.
Well, I have noticed on several occasions him go out of his way to make sure that you two aren't too intimate for too long.
Nonsense. What's to object to? Now, I have an appointment to keep on the moor, alone. To your happiness. And you are happy with me, aren't you?
I can't be happy as long as you stay here. You must return to London at once.
If you were with me, I'd be happy anywhere, but I can't leave.
There's nothing here for you but danger and death. Why can't you see?
I see nothing but you.
And I see only terrible things. You have to leave.
I'll only leave if you come with me. Thank you.
Sorry, Sir Henry, but I'm just as confused as you are.
That's it for my morning. Back to the hall. Say that he's not as crazy as I thought. But he didn't make quite the apology there.
Well, I'm glad everything's all settled then.
For now, at least. So, are you ready for our work tonight? To catch Barrymore to see what he's up to creeping the halls at night?
Completely.
Right. Put out that light, and we'll wait here for you. Even the ones on the second floor.
Yes, sir. Oh,
now look here, man. We'll have the truth one way or another. No lies! What are you doing at that one particular window?
There's no harm, sir. I was only holding a candle to a window.
Why?
Please don't ask me, sir. I promise you it is not my secret. I cannot tell it.
It must be some sort of signal.
No, I assure you it is not.
You're denying it was some sort of signal. Come on now, man.
Who's out there?
What conspiracy is going on?
I cannot say, sir.
Then you're fired. Right now. Go on. Get out!
Very well, sir.
I can't believe this. Your family has served mine for over 100 years, and here you are with some blood against
me. No, sir, no, not against you!
How long am I till we must pack?
Oh, John, what have I done to you? It's my doing, Sir Henry. All mine. Everything he has done has been for my sake. I've asked him to.
Asked him to do what? What's going on in this house?
It's my brother, sir. My miserable brother's out there starving on the moor. I couldn't just let him starve. I just couldn't. In spite of everything, he's still my brother.
is the
escaped convict, Selden the criminal.
That's the truth of it, sir. Now you see why I couldn't say anything.
My maiden name was Selden, and he's my younger brother. And I admit we spoiled him, sir, spoiled him rotten. He came to think of the whole world as his plaything. And when he grew older, he fell with a bad crowd and dragged our name through the mud. Oh, how it broke Mother's heart to see him sink lower and lower. It was only by the grace of God, sir, that he was spared from the gallows. But I will always see him as the killer!
He's got some nerve, signaling from the moor. Any warden can spot him.
You know, it's very likely that the signal can only be seen from that particular window.
It can't be very far if he's got to carry food out to him at night. Think of it, Watson. He's out there right now. Wait. I'll nab him myself and I'll turn him into the wardens.
I'll go with you. It's our duty to put him back behind bars. We can't trust that he won't hurt anyone else if we don't.
My thoughts exactly. Come on, grab your gun and let's go. If we get them before we have a chance.
Can you see the light?
I think so. In that direction.
We have to catch him fast. He's dangerous and desperate.
Right. What would Holmes say about this? What was that about? The hours of darkness and the powers of evil are exalted. God, what was that?
I don't know.
Hound, can there be really any truth to all this, Watson? Am I in danger of some dark curse? You don't believe it, do you? Not at all. There's one thing to laugh about in London, but it's something completely different out here in the middle of the moor. To hear that awful sound. And what about that footprint? Footprint is on his body. God, it all fits. It all fits. I'm no coward, but that sound frozen to the core. Feel my hand.
Cold as ice, but but I imagine that by tomorrow you'll feel better and forget all about it.
No, I'm not getting that sound out of my head anytime soon. At least it sounded like it came from far away.
It's hard to tell where it came from.
It came from that direction. Isn't that the direction of the great Gripen Mine?
It is.
It was from there, I can assure you. What do we do now?
You want to go back?
No! No, no. We came out the other end. We'll do it. Think of it, Watson. We're after a convict right now, and there's probably a hellhound after us too.
Oh, nonsense.
Right. Come on. We'll get our man about what fiends and hell are loose on the moor tonight.
There! There he is! Watch out! Stop!
Damn it! Where's he gone?
I can't see him anywhere. We might have to admit defeat and head back to the hall.
Come on, Watson. We know he's close. We can pick up on his trail again.
Not in this darkness. I can't even see the light of that candle anymore. Our only hope is to go back to the hall as we regroup. Anyway, wait. What's that over there? That's not Selden.
One of the wardens, perhaps?
No, that silhouette doesn't belong to anyone we know. Damn it! Another man on the moor, another mystery.
Maybe he can help us find Selden.
One way or the other, I'm getting some answers. I'm going after him.
It was a lot closer. Whatever it was a lot closer.
I agree.
Any sign of Selden or the other man?
I can't see either of them. Blast, we've lost them both.
I hate to admit it, though. But we should head back.
But that other man may have the answers we need.
Maybe so. There's no way of knowing. And besides...
Oh, besides what?
Besides, the hours of darkness and the powers of evil and all that.
You don't really believe all that binary, do you?
I don't know what to believe. All I know is that my blood runs cold every time I hear that sound. I'm afraid I won't be comfortable enough until I'm in front of a roaring fire and a very large glass of brandy in my hand. There's something unnatural going on around here, Watson. I can swear to it.
Well... whether or not the threats are supernatural, Holmes did say to keep off the moor after dark. Back to the hall.
Yes. So.